In this section, we're going to start looking at waves, and especially transverse waves. Later on, we'll look at longitudinal waves, that is where you oscillate, for instance, a speaker, and it compresses and expands air, for instance, in front of it. That's a longitudinal wave, inasmuch as the direction in which the wave travels and the direction in which the movement takes place to create that wave, the oscillation to create that wave, is in the same direction. Then we're going to look at transverse waves. We're going to try and make these videos a bit different, where we're going to discuss concepts way before we really look at the equations and problems with the equations, so that we understand the concepts behind what is going on with the physics before we start to memorize equations, and so that we have a bit more ease in understanding these equations and memorizing them. So the first thing we're going to look at is this graph. Over here, I'm holding a piece of string and I'm shaking the string up and down. That's going to create a wave in my string. And we all know, it's been done at school, in as much as every individual particle in this rope actually stands still as far as the direction of the velocity of the wave is concerned. It just moves up and down. So every specific spot just moves up and down. But that gives a certain velocity to this wave. And we're going to look at equations for velocity. The highest point, or lowest point, in other words, the point furthest away from this equilibrium level, where I held it first, the rope first, and I start moving it up and down, is the amplitude. Okay, so we've got amplitude. If I move my arm further up and down, so from the resting position to the point furthest away, and we know if we look at something the other way around, it's actually a circle with an angular velocity movement there. It's not confused with that. The further I move up and down, the larger my amplitude is going to be. There's going to be a certain wavelength. And the wavelength is from one specific spot, not there. We're not back to that specific spot. We need to move through a whole cycle back there. If we looked at it again as a circular motion, we need to go all the way around the circle. So we've gone down, we've gone, well, let's start from there. Say, for instance, that's that spot. We've gone down there, and we've got to go all the way back up there. So even if I measured it from there to there, one peak to one peak, one trough to the next full trough, that is going to be one wavelength. That's going to be our wavelength of one wave. So if I had taken that position, it'll have to go all the way back to that position. That also will be a wavelength. It's going to have a certain period for me to do this circular motion. It will take a specific amount of time for one rotation. So from the wave traveling from there to there will be take a certain amount of time, and that is the period. I can also recall that T, which we'll remember. And there'll also be a specific frequency. So past any spot, so many waves will pass per second. That is the frequency. So this is measured in seconds, SI units, and this will be per seconds. It's a waves per second, also known as the hertz. After a famous physicist, it's also the hertz. And we'll jump into one equation, we'll also know that period equals 1 over the frequency, or the frequency equals 1 over the period. That's how many waves pass per second, and how long does it take one wave to pass past a specific point. So we understand what transverse wave motion is, that movement up and down. Two equations that we're going to deal with here, only two in the first section. The velocity at which this wave travels is going to equal frequency times the wavelength. This frequency here times this wavelength here. So this wavelength is gamma, and it is measured in meters. SI units is going to be meters, and then the amplitude A, we'll see later, that's of course also in meters. So this is going to be a meter per second for velocity. And in any situation, my velocity, we'll see later, will remain constant, and as I change the wavelength in one direction, the frequency has got to change in the opposite direction to keep this constant. When we talk about, for instance, a rope, and we're going to send a wave down a rope, we've got another equation that we need to memorize, and that is that the velocity is going to equal the square root of the tension divided by the mass per length. So you're going to get a problem which is going to state that you have a rope tied to that end, and it's sort of going to go over a pulley and hang on this end. I can put a mass here, and I can give that mg, so we'll have a force of gravity on here, which is just going to be equal to the tension in this rope. And I start to oscillate on this side, so I set up a wave in this piece of rope that has some tension in it. And this piece of rope will also have a mass, so it weighs X amount of kilograms, and it also has a certain length. And if I divide mass by length, I'm going to get kilograms per unit length. And so here on top we're going to have kilograms, meters, kilogram meter per second squared, and in the denominator we're going to have kilograms per meter, kilograms per meter. If I cancel those two out, bringing the negative one up, I'm going to have meters squared per second squared, meters squared per second squared, but I need to take the square root of that, so we're going to be left with units of sort of meters per second. So if we just look at the units, we analyze the units there, we see that this indeed does come out as meters per second. So the tighter and the more weight and more mass I put on my system here, the higher the tension, that means the velocity of the wave is going to travel a lot faster, that makes sense. If I have a heavier rope, on the other hand, the velocity is going to be slower as this mass increases the denominator. And because this is mass divided by length, think about it, I can also write this as, I can bring this length up in the denominator, in the numerator. I can bring this length up in the numerator. In other words, also the larger this length is, the higher the velocity is going to be versus a shorter length. So this is enough about transverse waves and just understanding what lies behind the equations that we're going to get, problems that we're going to do with transverse waves. Not to insult your intelligence, but let's start with a very simple problem. We're told in a certain material, the wavelength is measured to be 18 centimeters. We can immediately convert that to SI units. That's 18 times 10 to the power negative 2. Centi means to the power negative 2 meters. And we're looking at a frequency is measured of 1900 hertz. That means per second. What is the velocity of the wave through that medium? Velocity equals frequency times the wavelength. So we're going to have 1900 per second times meters, 18 times 10 to the power negative 2 meters, and we'll get an answer in meters per second. So that's how we look at velocity. It's always going to be directly proportional, or it's going to equal directly the product of the frequency and the wavelength. Now we've looked at our first equation. Here's a problem with our second equation. We are given a horizontal rope, which is 5 meters long. 5 meters long rope, lying horizontally. It has a mass of 1.45 grams. You can immediately convert that to SI units by saying 1.54 gram is 10 to the power negative 3 kilogram. In it, we set up a wave by moving one end up and down. And the wavelength is 60 centimeters. That's 60.0 centi is negative 2, so 10 to the power negative 2 meters. And it oscillates at 120 hertz. That means 120 waves pass beyond any point per second. And we want to know what must the tension be in that rope. What must the tension be in that rope? For us to know what the tension is in that rope, we need to know what the velocity is of the wave that passes through there. Because, remember, we mentioned that velocity is going to equal the square root of the tension divided by the mass. Mass per unit length. Mass per unit length. We do not know what the velocity is. It was never given to us. But we know another equation for velocity. And we know that that equals the frequency times the wavelength. And certainly all of those we were given. So do we understand this concept though? It's difficult to understand. We'll look at the derivations later maybe. Perhaps. But the higher the tension in the rope, the higher the velocity is going to be. The higher the mass, the lower the velocity. The larger the length, the higher the velocity is going to be. And we know velocity equals the direct relationship of between frequency and wavelength. If you multiply them, you get the velocity. So this boils down to very simple algebra. In as much as T L over M is going to be F squared lambda squared, and T is going to be F squared lambda squared times the mass divided by, where are we now, divided by the length. We were given the frequency, we were given the wavelength, we were given the mass, we were given the length. So easy for us to calculate the tension that is, has to be in that rope for the specific velocity, which is going to be the product of the wavelength and the frequency. A much more interesting problem. We have a 20 meter flexible cable hanging. It hangs 20 meters long. And it has a mass of 5 kilograms. We are told at the top it's been vibrated at a frequency of 7 cycles per second, 7 waves per second, 7 hertz. We want to know at the midpoint what is the velocity of waves passing past it. This has been jiggled there. The wave travels up and down. At the midpoint, 10 meters, what is the velocity? What is the frequency of the waves that pass past that midpoint? And what is the wavelength? Can we answer that at all? Can we answer this question at all? All we know about waves, the only equations we know about waves is that tension divided by mass divided by length. That's all we know. Certainly we know that if we multiply these two, we're going to get the velocity. We have neither. We don't even have the velocity. So we have nothing of this part. How are we going to get to the answer of this problem? Do we know the tension? Yes, indeed we do know the tension. We know what the tension is at that point. That specific point in the flexible cable supports this mass. Supports this mass. So the tension there is going to be only half of this mass. So half of the mass times, well, gravitational acceleration, g. So in our instance, it's going to be half times mass. It's 2.5 times 9.8. 2.5 times 9.8. And 2.5, where am I? Half times mass times g. Newton. So we know what t is. Suddenly, out of this jumps the velocity. Just by realizing that the tension in the rope here, this piece of the rope, supports the mass of half of this wire. If we know T, we know M, we know the full L, suddenly out of this jumps the velocity. Still we have two unknowns to get. Doesn't matter what I do, I still have two unknowns here. I have this one, I don't have those two, I have all of those, I have these two. I need to figure this out. And it's quite simple. In as much as if I start wiggling this elastic, flexible wire, at no point in this wire will any waves bunch up. So if I start a wave here at 7 Hz, it's still going to be 7 Hz down here. It's not going to bunch up here so that all 7 doesn't come out there. So frequency is still going to be 7 Hz. And the v equals frequency times lambda. We know that lambda equals velocity divided by frequency. I know what velocity is now. I've just calculated it because I know t and I know everyone else. I know the velocity. And the frequency is still going to be 7. It's still going to be 7. Easy then for me to look at what the wavelength is going to be. So all of this comes from the fact that you realize that the tension here is half the mass of half of this wire times g. That is the tension at this freely hanging flexible wire.